Hi, I'm Dr. JJ Wicker.
And I'm Dr. Lindsey Tuba.
Today, we are going to be talking about when it is appropriate to sedate your child for an auditory brainstem response exam. However, before we do that, we just want to remind our listeners to please like and subscribe to this page and click the notification bell so that when we come up with these new topics and videos, you'll know that they're out and you're ready to share them with the world.
Yeah, so I'm really excited about today's topic because it's a little bit of a hot topic in that a lot of times you may have a physician or even an audiologist say your child needs to be sedated to have an ABR, which is an auditory brainstem response test. And I get a little bit heated in this topic, to be honest, not because a sedated ABR isn't a great test to have and very much needed, but sometimes I think that they're over-referred for. So I'd like to talk a little bit about that, but then we'll get into talking about exactly what a sedated ABR is.
Right. And so as a reminder, an ABR is normally the test that we do for infants because it's something that doesn't require them to behaviorally tell us that they are hearing a sound. So that's why this is a bit of a hot topic, is sedation is usually the last resort for when we aren't, despite all the tips and tricks we've talked about so far, some kiddos are just not able to condition to the booth testing that we typically would do to get their hearing acuity. And so there are instances when I think it is appropriate for a child. And the examples are, in my life, the examples, in my line of practice, I should say, the examples have been children who are just very low functioning, have other disabilities. Sometimes that can be autism.
Yeah,
I've seen that before. Usually though, it's been like cerebral palsy. I'm trying to think.
There are a lot of other comorbid things that could be playing into it that would require a sedated ABR. And I think the biggest take home that I would suggest is just to make sure before jumping into a sedated ABR that you've tried everything.
Right.
Even if you or an audiologist or your physician feels like, oh, they're not going to be able to get the information that they need. We hear that so many times, and then we end up being able to get that information, and you go through the cost,
the risks. Yeah.
And also just, that's a long day, a child getting an IV, and I don't want to use the word traumatic necessarily, although going to a hospital can be a little traumatic. So really, while we are not in any way against a sedated ABR, we try to avoid it at all costs before moving to that.
And again, I feel like this is where we just keep bringing up this overarching theme of looking for someone who has good, strong experience working with children. Because again, we've worked with these populations a lot, these difficult to test children, and we're able to get good information. And so that's what can happen though, is we have maybe ear, nose, and throat physicians or other adult audiologists who work primarily with adults who might think that a sedated ABR is the right course, but it's only because there hasn't been the appropriate attempt first.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about our clinic, is we have kind of those protocols in place to say, you know, that's a thought, but let's try first, because if we get two pediatric audiologists in that booth, I would feel like 9 times out of 10. I mean, that's not a real statistic, but I feel like the probability of getting good, solid information from the booth is a lot more.
Yeah.
Viable.
And also if your child, even if they're older, if they will just sit and take a nap. I remember a case that I had, where we were getting to the point where we really needed to do a sedated ABR. This child was 3 and a half, and she had ADHD quite significantly and just bouncing off the walls. But mom was very hesitant to do sedation, understandably. And she said, I think that we can get this done in the office. I think I can get her to sleep. And in my head, I was like, I don't think you can. But then she said, I'll sleep deprive her. We'll come into the office. We'll have a dark room and I'll get her to sleep. And she did. And I was so surprised. And we were able to get a natural sleep ABR, which is so much less traumatic. Obviously, the cost is much less than going to a hospital getting sedation. However, sedation would have been a good option for her had that not worked. That's where we would have gone next.
Right. So. Well, and I think that's a great testament to why we trust parents as experts in their own children. If a parent says, I can get my child to nap, I've had that same experience too. where a parent says, I think my three-year-old can nap, and I'm just like, in your arms? Because that's what it's going to look like. Are you sure? You know, and I doubt myself, but then sure enough, the kiddo comes, and they just, we turn off the lights, and they fall asleep. Maybe yeah. mom or dad plays a little bit of music or something like that. So it is feasible. One thing I would say, though, is if sedation is, you know, we've tried and exhausted our things, when can we make sedation efficient? And I think what I mean by that is your child already going to have another operation?
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. So if your child's having another operation, say they're getting tubes placed in their ears, that's a big one. Or they're getting sedated for an MRI. That's right. another thing that happens often. We can piggyback those tests together. And that really is so that the child's only being sedated once. So if you know your child is going to need a sedated ABR, but they also have an upcoming procedure. Some kids get sedated for dental work. Most of the time, we can piggyback an ABR onto those other procedures. That way, you're preventing the sedation twice. It really is best for everyone involved.
Yeah, and there's different levels, and of course, you can please ask your primary care physician about the details. But there's different levels of sedation too. And so I worked in the NICU for a while there, and it was pretty common that you know these little infants are in a lot of distress, and sometimes it actually works against them to try to do a natural sleep ABR because touching them causes their hearts to soar, you know, those kinds of things that can actually be really bad for them. And but a lot of times those little babies in the NICU can get a little bit of bedside sedation to help at least keep them calm during the exam. So there's mild, but then there's also, of course, general anesthesia. And and so, again, just weighing the risks to know what each case can look like, but what the benefit for the outcome can
be. And definitely, I'll just reiterate that I would try basically everything possible prior to going to sedation. And then if you have tried everything, feeling comfortable that, okay, this is really what needs to happen in order to get hearing thresholds for my child. I'm trying to think. One thing that I do that I am a little passionate about is not sedating unless absolutely necessary or if they're already being sedated for another test. Is in an infant under 6 months old, I can't think of a time in my 20 years of being an audiologist where I haven't been able to get a test without sedation on an infant under 6 months old. And you may have a different experience
other
in the NICU.
The NICU, right.
Yeah.
If
you have a child that's under 6 months and your physician has recommended sedation, I would question that.
Yeah.
Because typically we can get what we need to get without sedation at a much lower cost, a much less impact on both you as the parent going through it and the child as well. So if you have an infant, a natural sleep ABR is almost always going to be more beneficial than going under sedation.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, in my NICU, they weren't like totally, you know, sedated. It was
more
just about keeping them calm. And that was just a comment to refer to like the kind of the spectrum of what sedation can
look like. Yeah, and I think that's a good point is that sedation is not sedation. You know, there are a lot of different levels of sedation and most places, obviously every place will be different and every doctor will be different, but whoever's administering the sedation usually starts with the lightest sedation possible, and then depending on how your child does, just slowly increases because they want to sedate them as little as possible.
For as short a time as possible.
Yeah, exactly. Time frame, I think you can expect the actual test itself, once the baby or once your child is sedated, the test itself only takes about 45 minutes to an hour if you've got a good audiologist running the test. But you end up spending a lot of time in the hospital just getting the child checked in, getting the IV. My sister-in-law ended up having a sedated ABR on my nephew. And they were there for almost all day just for the ABR test. He wasn't being sedated for any other procedure. It was just the ABR test. And it took almost all day. And so it can be an exhausting day. Not to discourage anybody who ends up needing that, just know that that's what to expect time-wise. Take snacks and get a good night's rest prior, because as a parent, it can be be kind of exhausting.
For sure.
But we're here to support you in all of that. So please, again, subscribe to our channel and like us, and the little notification bell thingy that we always
click
say inappropriately. Click it. Leave your comments and your questions, and we're happy to answer those. If you have any ideas for future videos, please let us know.
Have a good day.
Bye.